Let's start with the new topic today. We have so far done the basic of crystal growth. We have done how a clean room is working and how do we actually go into the clean room and what are the requirements. We have also seen the incorporation of impurities through the process called solid state diffusion. Then we looked into oxidation. Then we have also looked into lithography, how to print the image, okay, or the patterns. One of the possibilities of incorporation of impurities, or rather the one which is nowadays used, is ion implantation. The word itself suggests something has to be implanted, and the thing impurity ions. Okay, so we start with the little bit basic thinking on implantation. By the way, implantation has nothing to do only with VLSI. This process is known to us for almost 100 years. It was late, very late in 80s, that it was first time used by VLSI people. Implants were known many, many years ago. Okay, so don't think that this is very recent or something. So the machines then were different, machines now are different for semiconductors, but otherwise basic idea is same. Ages ago, this is for us only specific. Implantation is a process where we can incorporate dopant impurities in a substrate, and in our case it is mostly silicon, but it can be any substrate. Dopant impurities are created in their ionic form, and these are charged ions and therefore can be accelerated by electric fields. This causes increase in energy of ions. The ions are then focused into a beam and then they impinge on substrate, normal incidence. Due to high energy ions, when they enter substrate, they interact with the atoms of the substrate and therefore after a while lose their energy and come to rest at some distance inside the substrate, or the distance up to which they can go and rest is called range. Okay, is called range, up to which they can go in and rest or lose all their energy is called range. So we are trying to see, since I know ions can go inside a substrate and due to the interaction of atoms, they will lose their energy, and once they lose their energy, they will come to rest inside the lattice. Now whether they will occupy the substitutional sites will be decided by how much further thermal process we do for them. But mostly if there are vacancies are available, they will like to first sit somewhere there, but otherwise we may have to do something to actually force them to sit into substitutional sites so that they can contribute to conductivity. Now if you are noted down, the energy loss mechanism is what we are really interested in. How far they can go inside is what we want to know. And if you have noted down this, I will give another sheet to write down or another. Okay, so up to where they can go, they are decided by the energy loss mechanism is interaction of ions with nuclei of atoms of the substrate. They can also interact with the electrons in the lattice, and therefore there are two ways of scattering. One is the interaction between ions and the nuclei, the other between the available electrons in the lattice. The energy range relationship therefore can be created, and larger the energy, obviously it will take longer before they will come to rest. Smaller the energy, they stop at much earlier depths. Time for which these ions impinge on the substrate decide the total amount of, how long you do this much, this will decide how many impurities you are pushing inside. Okay, so this is something to do with the word number of atoms or number of ions per unit area, or called dose. So how many atoms per centimeter square we can push in from the surface inside is the dose given for this dopant atoms. Okay. Now generally, since there will be lot many number of ions and they will be impinging on substrate, the randomness in their coming and hitting the atoms, because atomic positions and where they hit, what angle they hit, they normally will get randomized inside. And this random nature of atoms coming inside a lattice essentially leads to a random distribution, which is the most common distribution called Gaussian distribution. So most likely they will follow a Gaussian distribution from the inner depth. That means fewer at the surface, fewer at the bottom, and maximum in the center. Okay, so there will be some kind of a Gaussian profile from the depth side. Okay. Now this is essentially because we don't know which atom going where, so we say random numbers, larger number per centimeter square are entering, and therefore larger atoms they will be able, and there will not be only one interaction. Ion hitting one atom, then it moving away, it may hit someone and then come down. So there is an average effect going on, and therefore it will be more randomized in nature. Okay. Now this is where the things are very simple, because once you say it is random distribution, it is a Gaussian profile, and what was the difference between solid state diffusion there, how the impurities were getting inside by complementary error functions. Now I don't need to have complementary, because the first time itself when I'll get in, I'll have a Gaussian profile, and any thermal cycle ahead will actually will not change the distribution or the dose, but will just flatten up. Okay, so more impurities will go ahead and ahead, and we'll see how many and where do they go finally. Okay, so this is very important, that the first time itself when I push impurities in, I get a Gaussian inside, okay, and that's something very easy for me to then operate at. What is the advantage? If I put a very short and very small time as well as very small energy ions, where will they rest? Very close to the surface. For a short time, I know how many small number of impurities per cc per centimeter square I am pushing in. So what is the equivalence of that in a solid state diffusion? A sheet charge approximation we were trying earlier is much easier to control now, because I can decide my dose as well as my time and can create surface charges. Okay. And that is the beauty of implantation. Okay, so let me say something more about possible processes. The dopant incorporation in semiconductors, we have seen so far solid state diffusion is the most earliest version which we have discussed a lot. We also have seen during crystal growth I can add impurities and therefore incorporate impurities in a crystal. Process which we have not done is epitaxial growth. So during epitaxial growth also you can dope the wafers or dope the silicon or any other substrate. We can also do some part of what we call as during CVD using doped glass. This possibly time permitting I'll show you. This is called poor man's implanter. At atmospheric pressures, low temperature, CVD using doped glasses, I can push impurities in, and this process was suggested by Andy Grove way back in 60s, and we call it poor man's implanter. If you don't have an implanter which is very costly, to some extent you can play with this smaller CVD system, okay, not accurately but some way. And of course we can always put the impurities inside what is called process of ion implantations. Now why are we looking for ion implantation compared to solid state or any other process? Of course the second and third, that is crystal growth doping and this, has the biggest advantage that they are during the growth of the lattice, and therefore they are uniformly distributed. So if you are having a uniform doping, only two processes can do, either during the crystal growth or during the EP growths. Okay. Otherwise there will be always a profile in. Okay. So advantages of ion implantation are the precise control of impurity dose and depth, which I just now said. I can decide my time, I can decide my energy, and therefore I will be able to push exact number of impurities per centimeter square, and also I can decide how deep they should go depending on the energy I choose. Okay. So this is one interesting thing compared to solid state. Please remember solid state diffusion cannot be very accurately controlled simply because the amount of source impurities which are coming from gaseous phase to solid phase and then they react. Here we are not reacting but pushing in. Okay. The impurities directly below the surface can be created. We don't have to get into the silicon dioxide, okay. They can go below the silicon dioxide itself. Almost everyone can go below the layer, and therefore it's a called buried profile. I can do a profile which is in the silicon and not in any other material above. Okay. I can put energy which crosses that. Okay. Normal to diffusion, normally compared to diffusion, this process is low temperature process. This statement need to be qualified in the present context. See, you need to anneal the samples afterward, which is around 850 degrees centigrade. Nowadays, almost all VLSI, ultra large scale integrated process, can go below 400 or 300. So this is still not so low as we thought, but since solid state diffusion used to take 900 and to 1250, this looked to be very low temperature process. As of now, the variants of this implantation will be used, and we'll see that. That will be called plasma implants, which will be low temperature implants. The biggest advantage this allows is the choice of mask material. Since I am pushing the ions through any layer to a depth, what is on the top is not so crucial for me. Okay. So I can have silicon dioxide, I can have silicon nitride, I can have even resist, resist is very good because resist is resin, large carbon hydrogen chains, they are randomly distributed and therefore more likely to pass a stop implants, because they will interact right there with carbon chains and will not allow anything to really go actually. But if I push energy, even they can cross that energy. Is that clear? So mask is not that crucial in my decisions. So in many times I may use resist itself with a mask, because I have done a lithography resistor there anyway, I will start implanting. Okay. So I don't need to grow anything there. Okay. That's the biggest advantage implanter provides. Just as it is, it is roughly a high energy implanter, maybe 300 to 400 kV implanter, may cost around $10 million to above. So it's a very expensive system. Of course, there are many other gadgets these days inside an implanter, but apart from the gadgets, the cost is very high. So not everyone can buy, including our CN doesn't have an implanter, okay, for the same reasons. Our much of the money would have then gone to implanter. Okay. So that is what I said, that equivalence will do something. Okay. The next or the most important reason why it was used in VLSI technology was that it allows you to create what is called as self-aligned structures. We will show you this little later. Another very big advantage on this is that in the case of solid state diffusion, think of a situation, I want to make an NPN transistor and I have a N collector substrate. So first I will have to do base diffusion, and then inside that I will do a phosphorus or arsenic emitter diffusion. So first base boron and then followed by arsenic or phosphorus. In implant that's not so. I can first create emitter and then push the impurities down for P, which will make base afterwards. Okay. So it is, the order of impurities are not very crucial. Of course, it's not so trivial, but it's not very crucial as in the case of solid state. Solid state, you have to first create base, only then you can push the emitter impurities. That's not so much in the case of implant. I can just adjust energies, whichever earlier is not important. They will decide by the energy where they will come and rest. Okay. This is what someone was asking. Maybe Professor Mahapatra gave you a problem. Arbitrary impurity profile, any random profile, not necessarily Gaussian or not necessarily error function or exponential or linear grade, you suggest a very random profile and I can create any random profile using implanter. Okay. Now question another, why do you need a random profile? Well, we don't need all kinds of random profiles, but there is a subjunction which is called hyper abrupt junction. Have you heard of the word hyper abrupt junction? Thoda padho. Vector devices which are used in microwaves for generating the sources, or they are also used in the params, parametric amplifiers for microwaves, they actually need such high frequency reactors, and you need a hyper abrupt junction. Okay, hyper abrupt is some kind of inverse abrupt. Normally it is like this, here it is afterwards. Okay, so it is some kind of retrograde step, and we do that in mean case of CV adjustments. So for any arbitrary profile, possibly can only be done through implants, and no other solid state will never allow, because it will always through Gaussian or complementary error. All good things have some bad things to with that. The disadvantage is, of course, there is this throughput rate world has not that small as it was earlier. Earlier we used to have a chuck which can at best hold 12 wafers. Now we have implanter which can hold 48 wafers. So it's okay. System is big, energies are higher, big system, this hall kind of, at least half hall is the implanter. So many wafers can be simultaneously implanted, multiple beams can be done. So many tricks have been tried at the cost of money. You put money and maybe your throughput can increase. Okay. However, for a all small implanter which we couldn't buy even in our lab, which may have 12 wafers at a time, 8-inch wafers. Earlier we had 3-inch wafers, so it's much easier to put 12. Now with the same tech only one wafer may come. So it's a very tough situation. If you change technologies, you change wafer size, the every tooling changes. Every tooling, wafer racks, wafer furnace, everything changes. So much money. So no one wants to change sake of it. Oh, now market is available, buy it. No, no. Is it worth buying? The second advantage, disadvantage is, like in the case of diffusions, every driving cycle is with the oxygen, oxide. So it will self-oxidation is done there, so that next layer is on the top is oxide. So it creates mass automatically, okay. So it's called passivation, it doesn't allow other impurities to get in. However, in the implant, since it need not be oxide there at all, and therefore there is no self-passivation in the case of implant, you may have to actually dump oxide if you need. Since ions are high energy, maybe as high as 300 keV, because of that, this energy when it imparts to an atom, the first atom it will hit with such a large energy and momentum that it will displace that atom itself. Okay? It is likely that the silicon atom itself may get displaced. So the near the surface, much of the silicon atoms will not be in their lattice positions. So they will get damaged or amorphized at the surface. However, they are not so far away from their original positions, and therefore what will happen, that by some thermal cycle it can be retrieved back. Okay. But there is a damage. The crystal gets damaged at the surface at least because of high energy being delivered actually. There are also a problem which are called anomalous transient enhanced diffusion. Suddenly we find that I change the energies for some depth change. The profile should have, atom should have, actually ion should have rest somewhere here, but I see a tail. They are gone much deeper. We never thought of it, but it went in. Okay. This is called transient enhanced diffusion. So there are issues which probably are for different impurities at different times. Different doping of substrate may create what is called as tails. These are called Pearson tails. And now this is not every time true for every process. So one doesn't know how depth they are really gone in. Okay. So there is sometimes a issue which is called transient enhanced diffusion, TEDs. Since you are putting ions, and if there is an SiO2 layer here, and we have just now read understood the thermal oxidation process, we say all SiO2, if you put charge in, it gets there, and that's the VT problems. We are kept saying that you are putting ions anyway. Okay, so you are charging the insulator sitting there. Okay, which essentially means either the charge has to be removed. Okay, or other way it will create threshold problems if the charge is not withdrawn. Okay, so there is an issue in the case of implants that ions charges insulators. Okay, that's the way it is. Okay. As I said already, the equipments are very costly compared to solid state diffusion cost. Even for 12 inch wafers, the furnace cost right now $1 million, 4 stack. Okay. Implanter may cost, smallest 8 inch 4 wafers may cost $10 million minimum. Okay. So it's a cost wise, it's very exorbitant. However, as I say, if you look at the advantages, okay, which solid state cannot do, then there is nothing else of cause. I mean, I cannot do, so I will do whatever I have to. Okay? So, I will put money and will charge the customer at the end of the day. Okay? That is the way I will. Yes. It does. It is difficult because oxygen is not inside. Oxygen is, if there is oxide, there is an advantage or disadvantage, it is called precipitation. So, one of the problem of this is some precipitation near the surface, which is very bad situation because it will actually act like a recombination centers. So, one avoids oxygen doped wafers, and particularly we must avoid oxygen at the surface. Okay. So, there is a process of what we call as ionic cleans, and we actually remove the surface so that no oxygen is sitting at the surface. Actually, heating up is not that bad as you are thinking, because that the chuck on which this is sitting is cool chuck, so the heat is immediately removed. But I cannot say when they impinge, they don't increase the temperature. Energy is given, so KT is provided. But the chuck on which wafers are sitting have a huge cooling trap, so it removes the heat very relatively fast. Okay, so I am not trying to say it will not heat, but it certainly will not be so high temperature that it will damage you too much. See, let us say it goes to 100 degree, nothing happens. Okay, but if it goes to 800, 700, then I have a worry, but that temperature it will not allow to reach. Okay. Yeah, ion tail means the junction may be far away then, where we do not want. I want junction depth of half a micron or 2000 angstrom, it may go to 1 micron. No, but the impurities will further go down. If they drive in, will further push them out. So, the junction will further move away. Any tail, if during drive in, will go ahead. Okay. So, that issue will be even worse. Of course, Pearson 4 formula suggests how it can be done and what cannot be. But I think I will not go so deep, for because ion implantation itself requires 20 hours to teach. Okay. So, I will not do that. I will just tell you basically what we use. Okay. So, typically a machine requires what? It should provide for VLSI process? It should be able to give us uniform dopings. Uniform does not mean not profiled, but uniform means once I do it, I repeat, it should give the same profile. I should be able to put a dose of 10 to power 10 per centimeter square to as high as 10 to power 16 per centimeter square. Can you think what will be 10 to power 16 dose will be roughly in a 1000 angstrom depths? This will be 10 to power 21 per cc. Okay. So, it is a huge concentration I am talking about. 10 to power 16 per centimeter square is very, very heavy dose. Okay. 10 to power 10 is 10 to power 15 per centimeter cube roughly, and therefore it is normal dopings. Okay, so we must be able to adjust doping from 10 to power 10 per centimeter square to 10 to power 16 at best, because more than that crystal lattice will not be lattice. Area into depth is volume. Abhi 1000 angstrom is minus 5 centimeters, microns. So, minus ko karo, multiply, divide karoge to 21 ho jayega. Thoda jo bhi depth loge, usko usse multiply karo, okay, walls area ko. To volume per cc, aapko per cc karna hai na, to niche aur ek division lagao. Minus 5 se divide kiya to 21 ho jayega. Okay, energy of ions required with typical energy required for can be in some cases very shallow implants I need, then I may have, implanter must have energy of ions as low as 10 keV. And if I want deeper implants, I may, or what we will see later, higher current implants at higher energies, we may be able to. So, of course, I did not say, but larger the dose will require larger current implanters. So, implanters are classified as low current implanters, medium current implanters and high current implanters, depending on the dose you are really looking for. Similarly, energies could be 10 keV as small energies, and to be as high as 300 to 400 keV energies will be required for pushing ions well within the depths. Okay, like I'll show you a figure, a P well or N well may require a micron or a half micron now, whereas the source drain may require 0.1 micron. Okay, so I want a deeper junction, I also want a shallow junction. So I need energies varying from very low energies to very high energies. Okay. We should be able to incorporate all kinds of impurities, whatever we could do in solid state. Luckily for us, if I do a carbon implant or what is called as nickel complex implants on steel, it becomes hardened. One of the method of hardening steel is to implant either silicon or nickel complex as they called. And once you implant this, the tip of this, where from this, there is no one from mechanical, where do you use such things? The high speed tools which are used with lathes have actually a tip which is high speed steels, okay, with such hardness in that, but they should be able to edge the cut the steel itself, so their tip should be even harder, okay, and that is how it is done. Okay, so that's what I say, implants are not new, implants are of ages old process. We want to have a dose. Once I fixed a dose, it should be stopped after that. I don't want, nothing like this. It should happen, that's the end of it. It should show an end mark, okay. Everything should shut off. So it should be automated. We also should be able to tilt the beams to a certain angle if I need. I don't want always normal incidence. I want 3 degrees, 7 degrees. Can I do that? So it should be able to do even angular implants. In many processes of LDDs, structure of a MOSFET, we do 7 degree implants, okay. So that one side there is no impurity, the other side, you understood? This is a mask. If I do implants like this, this side I won't get impurities, but this side I can. So I can reduce my doping on one side. This is called asymmetric MOSFETs. They are used using asymmetric implants, okay, or in angular implants. Of course, one will expect all implanters should give at least moderate throughput or high throughput if it is possible. Okay. This is requirement, may or may not be met, depends on the money you have, this will be met. Okay. For there are technologies like CMOS, double gate, FET or FinFET or all kinds of structures normally require following areas are made there, P well, N well, I have a figure, I'll show you. Then we need channel stopper, depletion implant for depletion transistors, source and drain impurity implant with higher doses but smaller energies, threshold corrections, all these are requirement in a MOS technology. I'll just show you a figure after you write down this. Why are we trying to learn all this? Because when I go into the lab, I should be able to know where I am going to use what kind of implants. Okay. At the end, maybe after this implantation is done, we will, before we do epitaxial or CVDs, I assume you can deposit by some technique then, and we'll show you actual IC fabrication, 16 mass process, Plummer's process, or many other. I'll give you modification to FinFET, what could be done, what processes are changed to make a FinFET. Okay. So first thing we'll do is we'll finish implant, because without implant it's not proper to do for the full processing, though we also need lot of CVDs, but right now that time we'll assume I can deposit, okay, by some technique. You could have also said here anything could be. No, I think implant is more important, and therefore I thought I'll first finish implants and then start looking for actual IC wafer fab. Okay. Our course is asking you to actually know how a fabrication process steps goes through. 16 mass process will how many real life processes? As I keep saying, typical processing sequence require 450 steps even for 16 mass. What is worst in this all processing? There are no retrace paths. Is that word clear to you? If I make a mistake on 336th, the whole wafer lot is thrown. A, okay. So there is no hope that okay, I can make an error. You can't. If you can make error, you will be out, so are the wafers. Okay. So no mistake. So much, why so much automation? The reason is this, because there should not be any possible mistake. Of course, all said and done, nature doesn't believe all that. It does make mistake itself. Okay, and then you are happy about it. I have not done it. The term which we were going to use soon, are terms rather, but one of the major two terms which I read, one is dose, and I say number of ions per centimeter square. Okay. If A is the area, then if the ions constitute a current, what is current? Charge per unit time. Okay. So current divided by charge is ions, numbers. This number in a given time t dash, if I integrate over a given time, divided by area is the dose. Is that clear? Current is charge per unit time. So current by charge is time, this. So for a given time, whatever is the integral of total this divided by number divided by area is essentially the dose. So what is the method I am now suggesting? Monitor the current, okay, and through which, how I monitor, with what kind of system? An integrator. So if I use an integrator and see that after given time how much is the dose, I can actually calibrate and say okay, here is the dose. Okay, this is what circuit will be allowing you to monitor it, and also therefore control it. As soon as you compare it with the given value of a particular voltage drop, it will shut off the source itself. Okay, this is what automation will be done. But let's see, this whole figure, whole of this may be understood through this figure. This is taken from Rochester Institute of Technology, Professor Hirsch Hirschman's lectures, available on website. I was looking for a good photograph, so I got one. Okay. I wanted also color photograph, so I was looking many sites in which good color photograph is there. Okay, so here is a typical CMOS process. Okay. In this only one of the channel is being used, either N channel or P channel. One can see from here, this is a STI, it's a trench isolation, silicon trench isolations. This is a new process, last 10 years. Earlier we used to do only channels, Fox kind of this, bird's beak or bird's crest. Now we will do STI. Then we have a source drain here. We have this LDD I was just saying, low doping density is somewhere here, or low dope drains. So we can use this. Okay. Then we have a gate which may be any insulator, and there will be separation from the drain to this is the spacer. Okay. Then there is a contact to the gate, either it can be metal, poly, or can be molybdenum or any other material which can form silicides. Okay. Why silicides? It should replicate metal. Okay. What is the advantage of metal? It's a conductive, very highly conductive material. So any silicide should be as high conductivity as possible and should also be able to stick to the gate insulator. Okay. So silicides, moly silicide, titanium silicide, tungsten silicide, all can be done. Moly is the most popular one which we use for work function engineering. 5 ms can be changed through this. Okay. Then there is a something called points through implants, which actually does not allow this channel to be connected to elsewhere. Okay. And this well itself is a retrograde. Retrograde means the doping. Normally, how do you put an implant doping profile? Higher doping ahead, earlier ahead, and then diffusion down. What is retrograde? Lower above and higher below. It's retrograde. Okay. So you need a retrograde wells. So how do implants allow you to do this? So these are the processes for typical one of the device. It is either N or P. Equivalently, there will be other device. So when you do this, you will block that. When you do this, you will block this, and you will do processing for both N channel and P channels. So yes, in normal solid state diffusion, either the source, if you are creating error function, it will start with solid solubility. So it will be always higher. So as you go down, that is in the depth, it will always redistribute and smaller values will come ahead. Okay. I want this area to be higher dope and the upper area lighter dope, because that is going to decide my implants, I mean my thresholds. So I want to retrograde. हाँ तो implant में कर सकते हैं, इसीलिए तो ये दिखाया जा रहा है कि what is the biggest advantage implants allows. Okay. Implant allows you to do any kind of, that's what I say, any profile. Give me any profile and I'll show you how it can be done. Okay. That is the biggest advantage implants allow. There is something we are doing through spacer. Firstly, you can think of it, this source drain somehow are not getting something which is related to silicides, but there is a possibility what is called as boron depletion. So I am trying to avoid it. Okay. So I will see why I need a spacer. Boron is always through oxide, it has a distribution coefficient will go in. Boron has a very high segregation coefficient. This is here, but no. When I do this implants, I do not want that to be seen by this as much. So I am isolating gate with source drains by implants. Okay, so that spacer is the one which stops that. Let's wait. Okay, I will give you actual in FinFET or everywhere. Why the major result of a process actually on a FinFET current, on current, is essentially spacer thickness, which is very funny. People never realize that the spacer is really causing so much worries. So it is the spacer which is deciding the currents. Fringe, of course, it depends on high K. If it is a low K, it's not that that worrisome. Okay. You are right. High K, of course, because thickness are high, there is a huge fringe. But otherwise, it's not so serious. Okay. So this figure was not to discuss on CMOS right now. This is only to show you how many places I may require implants. Okay. I'll do source drain. I'll do retrograde, I will do punch through implant, I may do for silicide, I may do sidewalls. I do everywhere, everything through number of implant processes, and which each will have something different profiles and different depths and different doses. Okay, that is the game we want to play. Okay. From where all these are coming? From my IV characteristics of a transistor, I figured out this is what I should get. If I have to get it, I went back and looked into structure. Oh, इसको थोड़ा सा हिला दे तो क्या अच्छा हो जाएगा, चलो हिलाओ. So that is how this is the DIOS programs or centers allow you to know which areas need some control. Okay. That's what all you do in a simulation. इसको ऊपर करो, इसको नीचे करो, इस पर profile डालो. क्यों देखते हैं? Because we want to see how what will actually affect the performance. Once I know that, then I will say, you will come to tell this technology man, hey, I want this. He say, are you kidding? Then he say, no, I want it. He say, okay, I will create a new technology for you. Okay. That is how the process is built up. Okay. I said, first two things I said about, two things which I said, first is dose, and second, the most important thing is a range. An associated word which we'll use is a projected range. Okay, we'll see what is that. After these two, we have a impurity profile. I want to know profile, how the impurities are inside the silicon. Since it's a Gaussian system, it will always have some variance or what we call a standard deviation. And in implant, that word is called struggle. The standard deviation is called struggle. So I want to know what is the struggle. Okay. I want to know at what energy this is to be done. So I need to know energy. Then I also have two terms of my interest. How do energies are lost inside a lattice of ions? So we say either they will interact with ion atoms or they will interact with electrons. So there are two ways energy can be lost. One is through interaction with atoms and nuclei, the other through electrons. So if they interact more with nuclei, then we say nuclear stopping. If they interact also with electrons, then they will call electronic stopping. We'll see this is our research. I mean, this is what we want to learn. We also figured out that when we do implant through a window, apart from this side vertically down, it also goes partly in lateral way. Is that clear? If impurities are coming like this, they also go laterally. This is called transverse straggle. This is one direction, and normal to that is transverse to this. So any variation, abhi variation kitna depth mein hai profile. Now on this side also it may vary. So this range is has a profile. Okay, ye jo profile hai, ye depth mein hai. Okay, but laterally bhi profile aa sakta hai. Uska bhi variation ho sakta hai. That standard deviation is called transverse straddle. We'll show you that. That is our research. Then there are two terms which we often use: annealing, because crystal is going to be implanted with high energy ions, they may damage a crystal, so we must recover it back, and also by during this thermal process or additional process afterwards, we may push the profile impurities to a known depth where we want. Okay, so we must push this by a process of drive in. Okay. There is also a word which will come later, we'll say channeling, something which we didn't want happened, okay, and we say why it happened. And of course, we'll like to know which mask materials we use during implant. Now, this is another figure taken from the same people. You want to still write on that? There is nothing there. As I said, these are all known. When you do a maths, you will see all these terms. I will discuss almost everything when I actually do the maths for that. Because for example, if I am passing an implant through nitride, how much thickness of nitride should keep? Or if I am passing through resist, how much resist thickness should be? If I am passing through oxide, how much oxide thickness? I will figure it out, how much. Okay. So I will actually evaluate that value, how much. Okay. So it's not really random. The process is random. Okay. We still can get some, but how do you get from very random process something? By a method which is called mean value theorems. Okay. Gaussian profile can always generate a mean and a standard. So we can average out many of the effects and say, okay, here is the way we can average is this. Okay. As soon as you have a normal distribution, much game can be easily x fx dx, one upon something, is the average effect. So you can always figure out a very straightforward averaging effect. Okay. So do some maths. Here again the figure from same Mr. Hirschman. This is how it looks to be. And since it looked very random, I thought this figure was brought specially for this. Ions are getting in, they are moving here and there, okay. Interacting with ions, interacting with electrons, and these are the positions at which they will come to rest. Okay. And equivalently, if we say there will be a profile in the depth, number of per cc profile in the this. Maximum is available here, so that is the peak value, minimum somewhere beyond this, and this distance as we call is the straggle or standard deviation is 2 delta rp, and we will discuss how much delta rp. So we have a graph which will give you rp against energy and delta rp against energy and also delta rt against energy. What is rt? Transverse straggle. So three graphs which are provided to you with your initial this, you can see there are three graphs given to you. One is giving the projected range versus energy. This is only for SI system with known impurities. Okay. Then we have given it for straggle, which is delta rp, which the value has been given, and we also have given a graph which is straggle delta rt versus energy for all impurities. Okay. So these graphs, so what is, why we have given you graph? Solving every time these equations and getting the value may be not easy, because it is a nonlinear equation, though we average out, so it is fine, But these graphs are monitored graph. What do you mean by monitored? I actually did implants number of times, measured actual ranges, projected range as well as straggles on profiles. This is done by actual physical measurement technique called SIMS, some other day, okay. Second year on mass spectroscopy, we do SIMS and we can do exact profiles, atom by atom. I won't say atom by atom, but large number you can say, but much more accurate profiling can be done. There are also processes, measurement technique called ESCA, but SIMS is better than ESCA. SIMS can be used in almost all cases, ESCA is only in certain cases only, okay. Then we can do XFS, we can do many technology, many measurement techniques which can give you actual profiles. So X-space is same, X-ray photoluminescence, so they are same, okay. Some call ESCA, some call X-space. So there are number of instrumentation techniques available. Also in IIT Bombay, there is a center which is now called Nano Center or something. Is that okay? So what is the way it is? Why, is that now clear? Random world is how random? So you can see that actual, that's why as I say, last 1 hour, last night 1 hour I was trying to see various figures so that I can explain you what exactly I was saying random, what random, now you can see what random, okay. So I was trying to make a video, visual experience for you, okay. So if I can do it, of course you don't have time, you can claim that, you may have time for many other things but for this, so okay, so I will do for you. Before we start now, the little bit of modeling, though we will not go into too deep because this model which I am suggesting is credited to three people called Linhard, Scharf and Schott, or called LSS theory of this energy loss mechanisms. LSS was very popular theory till maybe 95 or 98. Till that time, this theory was used very heavily by everyone. Okay. By 90s, we have learnt a better technique of doing this. Of course, it was known even earlier, but we started using in all electrical engineering more vigorously, which is called Monte Carlo technique. So once we have Monte Carlo, we can have a pseudo-random generator program. Then it became very easy to do a Monte Carlo system, this, and much easier way to do this. However, Monte Carlo does not give any physics, it just simulates something. LSS at least will tell you what is the mechanism going on, okay. What is the even modern version of Monte Carlo? Another algorithm, CSS, CS people have come out and gave a good name, you know, because we are very fond of our lineage. So genetic algorithms, okay, they are modified versions of Monte Carlo genetic algorithms, okay. So there are many more. Now you come out with something else and you say, okay, here is another algorithm. Basic idea is randomize the process and take an average out of it, okay. So do whatever it is. So you must be aware, not aware, but all these techniques we learned ourselves because there was no other background with us, okay. Now there are books, there are journals, everything in our time, but that was fun, okay. Maybe this is also a fun. Let us say M1 is the, maybe I'll, this is also M1. M1 is the ion and small m1 is the mass of the atom or ion, which is traveling normal, and say this is our substrate surface where it impinges, okay. Now as it starts traveling with a velocity v0, so we may say it has a kinetic energy half m1 v0 square, and it has an energy equivalent of e0, which is kinetic energy. Ions are accelerated, so they have a kinetic energy which is half m1 v0 square equivalent to e0. Okay. Before it impinges on m2, m2 is the substrate atom, okay, which is at what is m2 status? it is at rest. Okay. Now our first assumption in this all kinds of this is, I think, way back in our schools, or maybe in first year, no, schools only. These days it may be on fourth standard also. In my time it was in 12th or something. We used to have the theory of elastic collisions and non-elastic collisions. Okay. So all our assumption is they are all elastic collisions, and which essentially means there is any reflection of this does not lose extra energy on that. Okay. Otherwise that E restitution coefficient has to be added to that. So all are elastic collisions. So as soon as it hits stationary atom M2, which has a mass small m2, for example, or I just casually either capital M1 or capital M2 also has a mass. So don't answer wo capital alag hai, wo same hai. Okay. As soon as it hits it, due to a recoil, depending on this, it may go into one direction at an angle theta to the direction in which it was appearing, and by same this will give you a recoil now, and this M2 will also move on the other side. Is that clear? So I want to know, this is called the theta, which is called cosine theta, is what I want to know. How much is the angle through which atom moves away? Okay. Is that clear? It's impinging at 0 degrees. Okay, and then bifurcates one atom. This may still have an energy which is E1, which is mass M1 and velocity V1. It may, V1 will be less than V0 because it has lost some energy. But M2 has gained some energy E2, which therefore creates a velocity V2. And this, please remember, this also is now moving. Okay. So is that clear? Why random? Because this atom itself is not at its original position. Okay. So when the next something is, it may hit somewhere else now. So there will be a random process going on. Is that okay? Stationary atoms have kinetic energy 0, moving atoms have kinetic energy mv square, half mv square. Whatever I said, we can write, need not write, I can just say it. This is a projectile, m1 moves along the projectile with an angle theta from the direction of m1 before impinging. And the stationary atom M2 moves in a direction theta, opposite side. Let us say P is defined as the separation between the two spheres. Atoms are assumed as spheres. Okay. When the collision will occur, the dia is 2r0. r0 is, let us say, radii. So if 2r0, if P is greater than 2r0, then they will be separated. They will go away. They won't hit. But if they are, P is, separation is less than 2r0 dia, then only they will hit each other. Is that correct? Two planes, one this and one this, if they are like this, they will not hit, but they are there, then they will hit. Okay. So condition of impact is that P should be less than 2r0, and when is P is equal to 0 means head-on collision. Okay. Of course, our assumption is elastic collisions, and therefore we can apply laws of conservation of energy and momentum. Two equations, energy is conserved and momentum is also conserved. Ek aya hit kiya, na aya. Is that okay? One atom ion is hitting to the next, it moves away with some velocities. So the output velocities are, output energies are half m1 v1 square plus half kinetic energies, half m2 v2 square, must be equal to how much? Half m1 v0 square, because that's the net energy. Energy is conserved. Okay. Is that okay? Whatever I stated, I just wrote down also, so that for your sake. This is also given in Plummer's book. Of course, this is their nomenclature, my nomenclature may not, they may have angle, there is another angle phi, we will not go into too much detail, they are very interesting theories of LSS, okay. But some other day those who are interested, maybe 3 hours I can give what is the implant theory. We have never said it so far. What I started, there is a mass M1. I never said charge. There is an atom with mass M1. So kinetic energy is half mv square. So no, P may not change. That's the whole fun. Okay, P will have some distribution. So just wait for it. From the law of energy conservation of collisions, half m1 v0 square is half m1 v1 square cos square theta, half m2 v2 cos square theta. V cos theta is the in the direction. Okay, so this clearly the kinetic energy of incident ion was, or incident atom was, half m1 v0 square, and therefore initial velocity is 2 by m1 e0 to the power half. By same argument, v1 is 2 by m1 e to the power half, e1 to the power half, v2 is 2 by m1 e to the power half. So I know the mass and I know the energy at which this, or I know the velocities, they are related. So I know energy is root of E1, root of velocity is root of E1 on each. Okay. From equation 1, we can find out cos square theta. We write cos theta is root m1 v0 upon this, then replace v0 from here. So I got e0 to the power half upon e1 square plus e2 square. So cos theta is energy dependent. Is it okay? Cos theta minus is minus cos theta. So it's same angle, the opposite side. See here, this is incident. If you are going, this side is still cos theta. This angle is still theta. It recoils. That's why elastic. Whatever goes up, with the same angle, this will go down. So I have a cos theta which I was looking for. I can get one more relationship of velocity with cos theta by which theory? What is being conserved here? Energy. But now we can also conserve momentum. Is that okay to all of you? I repeat, given in Plummer's book.
So can you show in the previous slide that theta for second term? But this should be 90
minus. No. That is the E. If I say 1, then it will always be, it will always split. Okay. That is the way I kept saying I am using my theory well. Okay. If you have written down this, then I can also conserve momentum. So I have m1 v0 is equal to m2 v2 cos theta plus m1 v1 cos theta, and from there again I can get a cos theta term. And using the last two equations, I can write cos theta in terms of energy and mass. I have just copied it. Maybe check this. Maybe some E1, E2 may have gone wrong, but 99% they may be correct. 1% error stands. Because I did not substitute myself and verified, but hopefully it is right. Okay, so in case, now I know, in case of an implantation, the kinetic energy about due to momentum gained by atoms of M1 and M2. This is what we are saying. Change in momentum is essentially force. So we are really looking for conservation of energy and momentum, and we know the angle through which it will get deflected will be essentially related to incident ion energy, the energy associated with deflected ion, as well as deflected stationary atom, and energy mass associated with them. Okay. So this relationship is not really used very often. This is just to show you that if I know my cos theta, I am not interested in exactly the position where they are. I will show you what we are interested, but this theta I know there. So I have figured out how much is the cos theta. Now your answer. Okay. You are saying now. What you are saying, that after all you are not having a neutral atoms. Okay. So when you interact with neutral, this conservation of M1, M2, M3 is fine. Okay. Momentum energy. But you are now looking for ions. Okay. Ions are charged species, and therefore they will also have some kind of potential associated with. Essentially, they will follow Coulomb's law. Okay, they will follow Coulomb's law. Is that okay expression? This potential due to electric nature of ions, essentially it will modify the actual transverse motions. Okay, it's called screening. Screen means weighing something. Okay. So if you are passing through a screen, some may go, some may not, either it is trying to weigh the initial position, change the input. Okay. So what this VR, a potential associated with ions, is it will actually modify the theta, what you are saying. Okay, it will modify. However, due to the charged nature of ions, they all experience Coulomb's force. This lead to a potential Vr, which is by Coulomb's force Z1 Z2 by R exponential minus R by A. This is solving the Poisson's equation in this case radially. Okay, R is the position taken. R theta is any coordinate, polar coordinate, where Z1 Z2 atomic number of atoms, M1 M2 are respective their masses, and we define a parameter A, which is called screening parameter, which, as I say, I will not solve, but it is related to this calculation using VR. It's a little long because you have to first then figure out how much they diversify, then this diversify due to electric field is how much it affects the mechanical energy. So a little complication. The final answer is this: this 0.885 A0 upon Z1 to the power 2 by 3 plus Z2 to the power 2 by 3 half, where A0 is called Bohr's radius, which is typically some number of angstroms, 5.2 or for different material. So basically what we are saying, that the screening potential Vr is integrated along the path of ions to get the scattering angle, and that modifies the conservation of momentum and energy paths. So both together modify, and depending on how strong is your Vr, it will actually modify larger or smaller. Okay. This is what LSS theory is all about. Okay. How do we now do it? I have a number of atoms with random energies, and I will put a charge with them, and will expect, I'll allow them random ions to move inside a lattice with random number atoms available, and I'll say whenever this average energy goes to zero, find out for each of them, okay, number of such permutations hittings. Okay, so some will stop somewhere, some will stop, and I will see whether it still gives Gaussian. If it gives, all this theory is not needed, because then I'll find they have given me Gaussian profiles. So Monte Carlo technique is much faster, programs are available, you need to have a pseudo random generator, which most programs these days available. The randomness should be at least thousands or above. Okay, if you are only doing 10 or 20, don't do, say it's a random. Okay, so if your random numbers are very high, then certainly you can do as much correctness as LSS theory wants. Okay, so is that to some extent I answered you. Before we quit, we will just show you some important things to happen. As we have said, there are two ways of relaxation of energy or scattering or losing an energy. One is we say nuclear stopping power, and the other we call it electronic stopping power. The rate d by dx, which is the gradient of energy loss, okay, as it moves from the surface, x is the direction in the lattice. Okay, energy is at the x is equal to 0, and then it goes in, atoms are getting in. So one says, if n is the number of atoms per cc involved from the substrate, then d by dx is minus n times sne into ace, where SNE is called nuclear stopping power and ACE is called electronic stopping power. Okay. The nuclear stopping power has been derived, and then its equivalents have been found to a great, to first approximation, the nuclear stopping power is more decided by the charges and the masses and not so much by energies. And therefore, SNE is equal to SN0, and this function has been derived, 2.8 into 10 to the power minus 15 z1 z2 upon z1 to the power 2 by 3 plus z2 to the power 2 by 3 to the power half m1 upon m1 plus m2, and the units are EV centimeter square, energy centimeter square, where I repeat m1 z1 are incident ionic masses and charge atomic numbers or charge associated, and m2 z2 are substrate atoms with mass and atomic number z2. Substrate ions. So SN0, what is the approximation we made? SN is independent of E, so SN is SN0, which is constant. Okay, which is constant. Why are we doing this? There is some reason for doing this, is the following. Is that okay? This is first approximation, which is called Pearson's approximations. Pearson 4 formula, as it is called. Okay. This is LSS. Pearson has actually worked with LSS theory. So this VR term was actually brought more by Pearson rather than LSS. LSS is a universal theory for any mass. Okay. Pearson is the man who actually worked for implants. By similar argument, it has been found that if I look for electronic stopping power, then it is proportional to the E to the power half, and proportionality constant is related to substrate, which is called K, and for silicon it is 0.2 or rather 2 into 10 to the power minus 16 root of EV centimeter square. Why root? This is E to the power half. Okay. So root of EV, that is why it will give EV then. EV AC also should have unit of EV centimeter square. So this is root EV, this is root EV, so EV ho jayega. Multiply karenge to EV ho jayega. So this is for silicon. For different materials this K values will be different. Okay. So if I now plot energy versus stopping power, exactly what do I plot? Energy versus stopping power. What is SN0 we said? It is a nuclear stopping power independent of energy, first approximation. So I plotted SN0, which is independent of energy. However, electronic stopping power is root of E, which is parabolic in nature. So I draw a parabolic nature for ACE, and I figure out somewhere at E is equal to EC, SN0 is equal to ACE. Is that okay? I plot ACE, I have SN0 here. When they intersect at that energy, SN0 is same as ACE. So can I find EC then? Because if I equate ACE equal to SN0 at E equal to EC, I will get the value of EC itself. Okay. Is that okay to you? SN0 is independent of E. AC at EC is KEC to the power half. Equate the two terms and get the value for EC. Okay. Before we come to this figure, let me show you this. Is it okay? So if I, what I said just now, equate SN0 to at E equal to AC, it is K root to power EC is equal to SN0. So if I do this analysis finally, I get EC is 1 upon K square this M1 upon M2. Now one interesting feature about this is, if you see that graph, what is it trying to say from the graph? Can you think of that? I already written. If E is less than EC, E is less than EC, which value is higher, SN0 or SNE, SE? SN0, because that is higher. If E is less than EC, just a minute, if E is less than EC, SN0 dominates, higher value. If E is greater than EC, SE dominates. So if E is, if E is greater than EC, electronic stopping dominates. If E is less than EC, nuclear stopping dominates. I have done some calculations for you for arsenic impinging on silicon at 250 keV. If you wish, you can call that E0 initial energy. I am implanting arsenic atoms, ions with 250 keV energy on silicon. Okay. These values are known to me. M1 mass for arsenic is grams per atom, it is called gram molecular weight. is 1.243 × 10⁻². If I want actual grams, what do? Divide by Avogadro's number. Okay, thoda sa chemistry padh lo. Za arsenic is 33. Z for the atomic number for arsenic is 33. Mass for silicon is 4.6628 × 10⁻²⁰ gram per atom, and Z2 for silicon is 14. So I now know M1, M2, Z1, Z2, and K for silicon is also known to me. How much? 2 × 10⁻⁙, e^(¹²). So that K is known to me, this 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 is known to me. All quantities are known to me. So what can I calculate? EC. Is that okay? I know EC. I have all the values for arsenic implanting at this. Okay. So if I do this, what is the EC I got? I got 13750 keV, kilo electron volt. How much energy I got? Critical energy of this EC? 13750 keV. How much was my implanting energy? E0 was how much? 250 keV. So what is the condition we have? E is much less than EC. So what will dominate? Nuclear stopping power will take care of actual energy loss mechanisms. So in d by dx, what should I put the term now only? -n into Sn, 0, because Ac is much smaller compared to Sn 0. Is that clear? What is d by dx? The energy loss is -n times Sne plus Se. If Se is much smaller compared to Sn 0, then I would say it is -n Sn₀. Then I can integrate this and find x at that where it will stop. Okay, that's the my purpose of doing all this. Just for the before we come to end. Okay, here is a we have noted down. So the, for, what is the way you have to do it? Given an energy, given the species which is bombarding, given the lattice. Mostly this data will be given by me. Okay, then figure out what is its EC, then compare that EC with implanting ion energy. If E is larger than EC, then you have electronic stopping. If it is less than EC, then it is nuclear stopping. So the d by dx relaxation term will have either SEE or SNE, not both. But may happen that at E equal to EC, both terms are equal, so multiply it by 2 and use it. Okay. Okay. Last figure for the day. Last show this again from the same Rochester University slide. One can see from here, this is exactly what I wanted to show you. This is nuclear stopping and this is electronic stopping. Okay, so you can have either nuclear stopping or you may have electronic stopping. Okay, and then since we know either of them will be, we know the expressions for either of them, I can always find the energy loss at a distance. Okay, that's my purpose of finding out. So how will I calculate where they will end? Where E will become 0. When the energy of ion becomes 0, the distance traveled is range. So we will calculate next time range. d by dx is known, so I have no slope. So when the energy becomes 0, I will say it has stopped. Okay, so distance traveled is range. Okay, we will come back to it tomorrow.